It's great to be here. Thank you so much for having me. And thanks, Betsy, for a great introduction. Let's see, what to say about this talk. I'm in the beginnings of a new book project, and it kind of comes from two places. One place is, you know, just to do a kind of, you know, a history of sorts of Black queer diasporic formations. That's one place. The other place is to experiment with the possibilities of writing a political theory that's not based on the usual suspects. So what would it mean to sort of try and develop a political theory, you know, from the history of Black queer formations, right? And so I started out, you know, wanting to do a kind of a history of Black queer diasporic formations that would also be a kind of history of neoliberalism. And so I started out wanting to focus on the 80s, and then I realized I couldn't do the 80s without talking about the 70s. So this is me thinking through the 70s as a way to lay that out, but also get toward the 1980s, right? So any feedback, comments would be great. And also, if you want to talk about how some of your grid or our reading, the reorder things, I'm happy to sort of draw connections between this talk and that book, okay? The 70s was a decade of breakaways and beginnings. In 1970, the US Black and Latino socialist queer group Third World Gay Revolution broke away from the predominantly white socialist organization Gay Liberation Front. In 1974, a group of Black socialist feminists in Boston began the Combahee River Collective. In 1978, the group's famous Combahee River Collective statement would be printed in Zilla Eisenstein's Capitalist Patriarchy and the Case for Socialist Feminism. In 1977, Black queers in the UK would attempt to break away and into the British nation, and in doing so, confront the politics of socialism, as well as the violence of fascist groups and the British government. For you, doubtless, none of this will come as a surprise, familiar as you are with the various social formations around race, gender, and sexuality that emerged in the post-civil rights period. But what we have yet to detail are the ways in which those formations occasioned sizable transformations in the programs of modern intellection and politics. More directly, Black queer activists, intellectuals, and artists were part of various projects to revise socialism in accordance with an interest in politicizing homoerotic desires and eroticizing anti-racist and socialist visions. In doing so, they suggested politico-theoretical formations with which we have yet to reckon, formations that signal the emergence of associative and affective intelligences that were largely unprecedented in the history of modern thought and politics. In addition to signaling the rise of new types of intellectual subjects, those formations suggested a change in the metaphysical horizons of radical politics. The conventional way of regarding the 1970s is as a decade of decline where anti-racist activism is concerned. But in fact, the period saw the rise of insurgent articulations of race, gender, and sexuality. For instance, the group Third World Gay Revolution was an organization that was created in the summer of 1970 by Black and Latino members of Gay Liberation Front. It split off from Gay Liberation Front because, as the founder said, quote, a need was felt for an organization that would bring together the gay sisters and brothers of the Third World, end quote. The organizers for Third World Gay Revolution felt that despite the fact that there were several organizations springing from GLF and that there were real efforts by that organization to combat racism, Gay Liberation Front was plagued by what they dubbed, quote, the racism inherent in any white group with white leadership and white thinking, end quote. From the start, Third World Gay Revolution started two consciousness-raising groups which were made up of Black and Latino men and women. It also sent 9 representatives to the Revolutionary People's Constitutional Convention, a meeting organized by the Black Panther Party in September of 1970. In addition to holding Gay Liberation Front accountable for its racism, Third World Gay Revolution also tried to cause radical heterosexuals of color to confront their sexism and homophobia. In a pamphlet called The Oppressed Shall Not Become the Oppressor, The members of Third World Gay Revolution chastised their sisters and brothers of the Third World for failing to deal with their sexist attitudes. They went on to argue, quote, by your counter-revolutionary struggle to maintain and to force heterosexuality and the nuclear family, you perpetuate outmoded remnants of capitalism, end quote. We can locate the efforts of a group like Third World Gay Revolution within the momentum of the period, a momentum that attempted to use sexuality as a force to gain political velocity and to redistribute the itineraries of radical liberation. One of the ways in which the anti-racist and sexual liberation movements of the 1970s rewrote political practice and theory was through their interventions into the erotic, into that domain that Audre Lorde characterized as our capacity for feeling, our energy for change, and our power to share in any pursuit with another person. By intervening into the erotic, those artists and activists unleashed unparalleled levels of oppositional desires and energies, a fact that made their organizations desiring machines. For example, Third World Gay Revolution 16-point platform, drafted on November 11, 1970, was part of that machinery of desires. We can situate the 16-point platform and its growing list of demands alongside other demands from the period, the Black Panther Party's 1966 10-point program and the Young Lords' 13-point platform and program of 1969. The manifestos, the program statements, and list of demands that typified these organizations were indeed the genres of that affective insurrection as well as public manifestations of minoritized desires. In Third World Gay Revolution's 16-point platform, they stated, quote, we want the right to self-determination for all Third World and gay people, as well as control of the destinies of our communities. We want the right of self-determination over the use of our bodies, the right to be gay anytime, any place, the right to free physiological change and modification of sex on demand, the right to free dress and adornment. The system must be changed. Socialism is the answer. We want liberation for all women. We want free and safe birth control devices on demand. We want free 24-hour childcare centers controlled by those who need and use them. We want an end to hiring practices which make women and national minorities a readily available source of cheap labor, confined to mine-rotting jobs under the worst conditions. We want full protection under the law and social sanction for all human sexual self-expression and pleasure between consenting persons, including youth. We want the abolition of the institution of the bourgeois nuclear family. We want a free, non-compulsory education system that teaches us our true identity and history and presents the entire range of human history without advocating any form or style. We want guaranteed, full, equal employment for Third World and gay people at all levels of production. Being interested only in profits, capitalism cannot meet the needs of the people. The system must be changed. Socialism is the answer. The list of demands the Third World Gay Revolution produced signaled the active emergence of a new kind of minoritized subject, one who would simultaneously insist on the rearticulation of the meanings of minority difference and the rearticulation of socialism as the political project that can accommodate that assemblage of demands. Part of that politics was an effort to assert forms of autonomy and embodiment as part of the critique of racial capitalism and as part of the effort to tailor socialist visions for a world with newly insurgent minority communities. This is the moment of a willful explosion of desires and associations, the building upon one set of desires and associations to construct new ones. For instance, the Black Panthers' 10-point plan and the Young Lords' 13-point platform and program collectively argue for such things as fair housing, education, the termination of labor and capitalist exploitation, food, clothing, free healthcare, and end to wars of aggression, prison abolition and the dismantling of US imperialism. Third World Gay Revolution built upon the desires and demands of the Black Panthers and the Young Lords by maneuvering those demands so that they spoke to queer subjects. For instance, a demand for clothing by the Panthers and the Young Lords is turned into the right to free dress and adornment for trans subjects. Hence, the right to free sex reassignment and gender embodiment becomes part of a rearticulation of socialist visions, pluralizing socialist politics according to the needs and desires of various minoritized subjects. In this sense, we might think of efforts like Third World Gay Revolution as examples of how radical desires were targeted for multiplication. The 20th century represents the occasion in which various groups of racial minorities attempted to stretch the possibilities of socialist radicalism. In the context of blacks within the Western Hemisphere, Robin Kelly notes in Freedom Dreams that black radical experiments with socialism in particular have a long history within the 20th century. Such experiments characterize the lives and careers of such intellectuals, artists, and activists as W.E.B. Du Bois, Hubert Harrison, A. Philip Randolph, Chandler Owen, Cyril Briggs, Claude McKay, C.L.R. James, George Padmore, Paul Robeson, Eslanda Robeson, M.A. Cesaire, Oliver Cox, Claudia Jones, Ella Baker, and Lorraine Hansberry. The participation of the aforementioned intellectuals in socialist politics is in many ways an attempt to protect the writerly status of socialism and radical liberation. Writerly in the sense that Roland Barthes defined it, that is the capacity for a text to remain open to revision and redistribution. We can partly locate the beginnings of a writerly attention to radical politics and philosophy with Marx and Engels, of course. As Lenin and Althusser have argued, Marx and Engels revised political and philosophical practice by replacing the hegemonic subject of thought and politics, the bourgeois subject, with the proletarian subject. By rewriting politics and philosophy, they demonstrated the writerly potentials of politics and philosophy, that neither had to be written from the vantage point of a bourgeois ideal. As Althusser argued in his writings on Lenin, Lenin showed that Marx's theories of capitalist economic formations led to a new practice of philosophy, new because those theories helped to usher in, quote, the practice of philosophy based on a proletarian class position in philosophy, end quote. Here, we might think of Marx as working the mutability of philosophy as a political practice, underlining the contingent rather than natural position of the bourgeois subject within philosophical and political production. In doing so, Marx demonstrated how philosophical and political practice could be innovated towards social transformation by basing that practice on a minoritized subject. But you can imagine that neither Marx nor Engels, or for that matter Lenin, could have dreamed that queers in general, or black queers in particular, would come to occupy that position in politics or philosophy. As this list of intellectuals and the discussion of Third World Gay Revolution suggest, socialism was undergoing widespread vernacular rearticulation. Certain forms of black feminism represented another vernacular engagement with socialism. Contemporary black feminism within the US emerged from 1968 onward, a period that historian Kimberly Springer describes as one characterized by how the civil rights and feminist movements and the escalation of the Vietnam War caused, quote, dramatic shifts in societal attitudes around race, gender, and sexuality, end quote. In this context, certain black feminist activists and organizations used the sign of black womanhood to rewrite socialist politics. The most famous revision during the 70s was, of course, that of the Combahee River Collective, which was by the late 1970s an out black lesbian socialist feminist organization. In their statement, the collective wrote, quote, we are not convinced, however, that a socialist revolution that is not also a feminist and anti-racist revolution will guarantee our liberation. Although we are in essential agreement with Marx's theory as it applied to the very specific economic relationships he analyzed, We know that his analysis must be extended further in order for us to understand our specific economic situation as Black women, end quote. Here, the collective uses the specificities of Black womanhood to provoke a retheorization of socialist revolution, a retheorization that might address the racial, gender, and sexual particulars of capitalist exploitation within the US. Those specificities would also inform the group's cautions about classical articulations of socialism. But we can also argue that the group's disagreement about what species of socialism might yield feminist and anti-racist revolution was not simply a disagreement with Marx. Indeed, socialist feminism was a contested ground where matters of race were concerned. As Sheila Sandoval has argued, inasmuch as socialist feminism proposed universal explanations for gender regulation, it was also the site for suppressing specificities of race. Hence, vernacular articulations of socialism were also modes of adjusting its aims and outlooks. What is remarkable about the documents of socialist organizations like Third World Gay Revolution and the Combahee River Collective are the associations that emerge from them. For instance, Third World Gay Revolution produces associations between the right to public queer sexuality, sex reassignment, an end to imperial domination, workers' rights, free daycare, and so on. Because of feminist, anti-racist, and queer analyses, you and I live in a moment in which we take for granted that these things belong together. But we can't forget that at one time, these associations were completely unheard of, a fact that makes them not natural juxtapositions at all, but events worthy of historicization and analysis. My use of the category of the association is partly derived from the 18th century philosopher David Hume, who in A Treatise on Human Nature, 1739, and An Inquiry Concerning Human Understanding, 1748, argued that associations name the set of principles by which the mind makes its connections, a set based on resemblance, contiguity, and time and place, and cause and effect. It's important to note that Hume theorized these principles of connection within the very moment in which the modern, i.e. British nation state, was coming into being. In fact, one notices that these principles, contiguity, resemblance, and cause and effect, are also the very properties that came to define the modern nation state and the understanding of the modern citizen during the 18th century. For example, Welsh, Scottish, and English peoples would, despite their differences, be made to resemble each other as symbols of British identity. As presumably contiguous entities, Wales, Scotland, and England would enjoy an apparently natural connection, therefore suppressing the arbitrary and historical nature of their association. As new peoples presumably united under a national identity, they would be asked to accept the notion that the nation state is the most powerful cause of all social outcomes in modern history. In fact, Hume said that this last relation, that of cause and effect, is the most extensive relation of all precisely because, quote, it has a power of producing a relation of cause and effect. And this we may observe to be the source of all the relations of interest and duty by which men influence each other in society and are placed in the ties of government and subordination, end quote. Providing examples of this power, he goes on to argue, quote, a master is such a one as by his situation, arising either from force or agreement, has a power of directing in certain particulars the actions of another whom we call a servant. A judge is one who, in all disputed cases, can fix by his opinion the possession or property of anything betwixt any members of the society. When a person is possessed of any power, there is no more required to convert it into action but the exertion of the will. For Hume, the relation of cause and effect is the most extensive
precisely because it is the basis for the extension and assertion of power. For the nation state, that relation of cause and effect, as the examples of the master and the judge suggest, is modeled through relations of force. Indeed, in Hume's theorization of cause and effect is the vexed and shimmering history of agency. By framing the history of modern thought within the emergence of the nation state, we come to a startling observation, I think. Nationalist thought was not simply an example of modern thought. Nationalist thought was by definition modern thought. Stated another way, if Hume's books were tools to get at what it means to think, then thinking was intended to be a way of being in and of the nation. Anti-racist and queer experiments with socialism were attempts to alienate this aspect of the relation of cause and effect, that is, the nation state and its embodiment of citizenship as the preeminent archetypes of agency. This was the context in which culture would emerge as a site of alternative agency, at the very moment in which the nation state's status as the grand cause of history was being passionately challenged because of wars in Asia and Latin America, as well as racism at home, and in those days in which heteropatriarchal nationalisms were being questioned as the cause that would yield revolutionary outcomes and effects, feminists and queer activists in general, and Black queer activists, intellectuals, and artists in particular, would attempt to designate political technologies that could usher in forms of liberation. In the UK, this is the period that Stuart Hall describes as the reversals of the Thatcher administration, reversals in the areas of social thought and in the ideological domain, reversals that entailed stemming the tide of anti-capitalist and socialist sentiment from the 1960s and breaking what the Thatcher government referred to as the spell of the welfare state, a spell that bound people in the UK to assume that the state could be relied upon for public support. It was also the moment in which populist and state forms of racism were directed at people of color in the name of law and order. Isaac Julian's 1991 film, Young Soul Rebels, attempts to dramatize the complex social relations that were bearing on Britain during 1977. The film revolves around the friendship between two Black men, Chris and Kaz, who make up the underground DJ duo Soul Patrol. Theirs is a friendship across sexuality, as Chris is straight and Kaz is queer. The film also represents an attempt to move beyond the forms of agency presumed by the nation state, revolutionary nationalisms, and established socialist parties. In the film, the domain of culture, in the forms of disco and funk, music and styles, emerges as a site of subjective and social agency. Moreover, we can locate the film within Black queer engagements with socialist politics in the 1970s as the film dramatizes the conflicts between an emergent Black cultural form, soul music in Britain, and the sanctioned politics associated with the Socialist Workers' Party and with reggae cultures within the UK. Indeed, the film problematizes socialist formations for the ways in which they suppressed articulations of race, gender, and sexuality. By way of history, 1977 was the year of the Battle of Lewisham, the event in which the fascist National Front attempted to march through a multiracial neighborhood, only to be headed off by a crowd of 10,000, a crowd made up of neighborhood residents, as well as members of the Labor Party's Young Socialists. One eyewitness says that he remembers a little Black boy skipping playfully behind the National Front members, presumably unawares of the gravity of the situation, but maybe not. 1977 was also the year of the Queen's Silver Jubilee, a moment that was used by conservative leaders throughout Britain to call for the unification of that country against the threat of non-white migration and the communities that had formed because of it. Indeed, socialists, punks, and Rastafari prominently contested the rise in xenophobia and racism within the UK, but oftentimes did so in ways that were restrictive around race, gender, sexuality, and culture. In one scene from the movie, Billy Budd, the socialist punk character, and Kaz's love interest, rails against disco, funk, and soul as mindless capitalist crap. In another scene, Davis, the Rastafari character, who works in the garage that belongs to Kaz's brother, refers to Kaz's sexual interest in white men with shouts of, "Man, white man, nastiness," symbolizing for Juden the rigidities of sex and race tied up with reggae and black nationalism. Contextualizing the dismissal of disco and funk within left cultures, Julian says, quote, "All the left had to say was that disco music was part of the capitalist music industry and that one should adopt the punk ethic of dismantling it. But what the left didn't realize was that their formulated slogan of black and white unite and fight actually had some reality in black popular culture," end quote. Julian goes on to say that 1977 was the moment in which underground clubs that specialized in soul and disco produced spaces that were heterotopic in terms of race and sexuality. As he says, quote, "In 1977, the consumer development which currently produces endlessly demarcated spaces, black clubs, gay clubs, etc., wasn't so well established," end quote. Clubs like the Lazy Lady and Global Village would yield wonderfully hybrid spaces, black, white, gay, straight. In the following scene, our main characters are setting up to DJ an underground club located in the crypt of a church. They start the soul set off with the song, "I Like It," from the jazz-inspired disco and funk band, the Players Association.
And this is Kaz.
Soul Patrol. You like it? I like it.
Players Association.
Diary of a Young Soul Rebel, the 1991 book about the film. In that introduction, he argues that the clubs were an index of black culture's aesthetic, ethic, and politics of reinvention. As he says, quote, "The reinvention started around the music, opening up a space for a whole number of transgressions, both racial and sexual," end quote. We might thus read the scene as a demonstration of the joy of reinvention. particularly in a moment of social and state repression. The club thus indicts the very necessary social and political function of joy and pleasure for minoritized and disfranchised communities, joy and pleasure trying to hold their ground as they talk to pain. Read as a political, theoretical exposition, the scene and the movie assert the necessity for producing the deliberate and regular conditions for joy. Push further, Julian's understanding of the social function of pleasure and reinvention in Black music dovetails with the historic roles that joy and pleasure played in post-68 Italian Marxism. As Michael Hart argues in the introduction to Radical Thought in Italy, A Potential Politics, quote, all too often, leftist cultures have identified a revolutionary life with the narrow path of asceticism, denial, and even resentment. With Italian Marxist theorists, however, the collective pursuit of pleasures is always in the forefront. Revolution is a desiring machine. This is far from a vision of communism as equally shared poverty, and much less a reference back to pre-capitalist communist forms. Communism, rather, will emerge out of the heart of capitalism as a social form that not only answers the basic human needs of all, but also heightens and intensifies our desires, end quote. Like Italian Marxism, the scene illustrates the collective pursuit of pleasure as the entitlement of the minoritized. The scene also dramatizes how cultural practices of reinvention can rearticulate the nature of cause and effect by designating joy and pleasure as levers for personal and social transformation. In the scene, pleasure becomes not only a kind of energy of and for reinvention, it also becomes a way of breaking up a day, breaking it up in order to make the day a little more humane, interrupting the terrible pace and cadence of a surveillance state. Indeed, if we situate the club scene alongside similar engagements with the social uses of pleasure, Third World Gay Revolution, the Combahee River Collective, theorizations of the erotic, Italian Marxism, and so on, we might say that the 70s was also a period in which artists, activists, and cultural workers deliberated against overwhelming opposition on the agentive potentials of affective and cultural productions. The histories of Black reformations in the 70s point to the ways in which small and intimate elements, associations, desires, styles, aesthetics, and affects became relays for emergent anti-racist and queer politics. This would be a very different notion of politics than the modern version, classical or radical, a version that has so often been premised on acquisition and takeover, a politics of the grand. These minor and presumably insignificant formations signal an emergent moment in which politics would widen its metaphysics to include not only the grand schemes of acquisition and takeover, but also the effort to radicalize the seemingly insignificant parts of life. It is the moment in which the ostensibly insignificant and apolitical would become part of the substance of political deliberation. In many ways, what we are approaching here is an appreciation of a historical shift in modern thought and politics, a shift occasioned by the politics of race, gender, culture, and sexuality. Foucault's theorization of effective history in the essay Nietzsche Genealogy History can help us clarify that shift. Defining effective history, he wrote, quote, historical meaning becomes a dimension of real history to the extent that it places within a process of development everything considered immortal in man. We believe that feelings are immutable, but every sentiment, particularly the noblest and most disinterested, has a history, end quote. This attention to effective history would be the stage for Foucault's meditations on discontinuity as a way of apprehending history. For him, an attention to discontinuity broke presumably unified elements into their sequential parts. The slow elaboration of instincts, and the rhythms that slot the body into various parts of a day. This way of writing history has political implications as well. In a theorization of historiography, Michel de Certeau wrote, quote, historiography's purpose is to construct a coherent discourse that specifies the shots that a power is capable of making in relation to given facts by virtue of an art of dealing with the elements imposed by an environment, end quote. The 16-point platform and program and the scene from the movie do something similar. They break life down into its constitutive elements, marking each element as a potential basis of politicization and transformation. With this framing in mind, one comes to the argument that writing history that tends to the elaboration of presumably insignificant and minor elements like senses, associations, affects, corporealities, and styles is not simply a way of describing subjectivities or providing cultural histories. This mode of historiography is also a means of specifying the myriad opportunities that we might use to deal with the factors imposed by our environments. Read and written as such, the histories of Black queer diasporic formations suggest that the intersections of race, gender, and sexuality connote a certain continuation, rumination, and investment of politics. Thanks.
Thanks for very exciting putting together things. I was watching during the break in that way one does lately of many episodes of the show all at once, which tends to ruin the show, kind of. And so in this case, it was Portlandia, and which has, you know, does have its things to offer. But it was the coffee shop manifesto, the barista manifesto episode. And I was thinking about, you know, the problematic of that show, that it works because it gets at something that is funny about the, for in this case, form of the manifesto. And, but its tragedy is that it doesn't necessarily leave room also to love the manifesto. And I do love the manifesto in a, as a genre, let's call it. And so I was intrigued by how very effectively you put on the same plane, you know, the philosophical disciplinary tradition, the manifesto, the act of dancing, the, you know, that the act of reading and writing manifestos, not just conjuring them. And I'm wondering, what's then the next thing? What's then the next kind of, not even, maybe practical isn't the right word, but how would we even imagine a meeting in which we took that seriously as a basis for our work and our thinking? I mean, is there, and I'm just wondering if people respond this way, because, you know, I don't have nostalgia, for instance, for the Panthers, but I have respect. And I think that's part of what is so well done in your work, is that there's respect, and maybe it's partly the distance of time, maybe sadly, or there's something that's now able to happen, talking about these moments that wasn't able to happen, I think even 10 or 15 years ago. And I'm not quite sure what that thing is, and I don't know if it owes any reality to the fact of shows like Portlandia, you know, if the comic relief side is required, or just what exactly is happening. But I'm just wondering if you have thoughts on that perspective and moving forward.
Yeah, in terms of like the manifesto as a genre, you know, one of the things that I, you know, want to do is precisely what you're pointing to, is like, you know, sort of engage the sort of the history of that genre and its sort of modern uses, right? You know, the ways in which it, you know, so oftentimes becomes the scene for projecting a kind of universal or uniform or continuous, you know, image of like radicalism and the radical subject. Like, you know, everyone thinks the same thing, they all march along, you know, in the same rhythm. you know, which is why I put stuff in there about discontinuity, you know, because I want to disrupt, you know, this thing that we think we know, right, the manifesto, and one, to sort of, you know, look at the ways in which it actually is trying to, like the 16-point platform, is actually trying to break things up, you know, rather than, putting things in a kind of univocal, you know, articulation, in a kind of seamlessness. You know, there are things there that just, you know, sound crazy together, you know? And there's a way in which part of what I want to do is to, you know, talk about the productivity of that absurd arrangement, you know, of things within that manifesto, but also to sort of see that as, you know, really a kind of social formation that you're putting things together in a moment in which those things are not supposed to be put together, in which, you know, we have received and we're part of a kind of history of these associations make sense. I mean, that's what that stuff from Hume, you know, is all about. And that's also what the formation of the nation state is all about, that there are certain associations that make sense, don't deviate, you know, from that set. And what you have in the 60s, 70s, and also the 80s is, you know, people violating, you know, that implicit edict, you know, to observe only a sort of a limited range and arrangement of associations. So that's one. The other reason, you know, you mentioned, you know, Black nationalism, and you said that you don't have nostalgia. I don't have either. But what I want to do is something I don't think I've really done, and that is to talk about how, for so many of us being Black queer subjects, you know, that was our first critical formation, you know, Black nationalism. So I, you know, was in a Black nationalist group in Georgia, and I had to found it as a high school student. And then, you know, if you go back and read, for instance, Jackie Alexander's, you know, work, you know, with that really powerful piece, not just anybody can be a citizen. You know, she begins with nationalism, you know, within Trinidad, Tobago, and the Bahamas, and said that it was the moment in which everyone thought that the promise of Massa Day done would be good. And then, of course, right after that, you have the criminalization of lesbian and gays, right? And so you also then have the sort of disillusionment, which is also then part of the kind of affective makeup, you know, of Black reformations, right? You know, in addition to, you know, the sort of kind of affective energies that are put in place, Black, by Black revolutionary nationalist organizations, the, you know, the sort of mobilization and radicalization of anger and outrage, the you know, sort of imagining coalitional forms that span geographic boundaries. You know, think here of like the Black Panthers' investment in the struggle in Vietnam. Right? At the same time, you know, part of that affective makeup, you know, is the disillusion, you know, around those things. So, you know, what does it mean? What would a historiography that puts that kind of sensorium, you know, on the page, in the book, look like? You know, what would it mean to call that history, right? You know, then your other question, you know, the other part of your question has to do with, you know, so what do you do with that, you know, as a kind of political strategy? And that's why I write a book. You know, one of the things that I wanted to do in writing this history, and one of the things that nagged me was, remember I said I started out with the 80s, and so there are these images that, you know, I hold in my head of, you know, people who, you know, were dying of HIV/AIDS or dying of cancer, you know, they hear about Dolores, you know, work around that, and yet they were producing. You know, so you have the Audre Lorde on one hand, you also have in that same grouping, Marlon Riggs, you know, the scenes of Riggs in Black Years and Black Ink, you know, literally on his deathbed, but trying to give direction to the students who are making the film. You know, so what, or you can think of other people who,
we're doing the same thing. You know, what kind of agencies were they mobilizing when presumably they had no energy to mobilize, right? It seems to me that, you know, that deserves some deliberation, right? Because we're in a moment in which there's been a kind of over-theorization of neoliberalism, you know, to an over-theorization that doesn't really leave, you know, us with a sense of how to mobilize energies, mobilize imaginations, you know, because we've been, you know, there's a sort of, you know, a kind of verification of incapacity, you know, with much of the theorization, right? So we're precisely in a moment in which we can turn back to those folks who were figuring out how to get up, you know, and need a vision and create a vision, you know, at the very moment in which, you know, they were being debilitated. So that's what's driving the project.
I love the project. I think to also look to the 70s is so important. It might be, you know, because of what you talk about, because of the 80s and HIV/AIDS, the 70s. It's the moment entire layers and stratas of societies vanished, and their knowledge and their entire histories of experience, the lived experience, vanished, died with them. And the embarrassments that were associated, and that hysteria is still not cleared. And so I love the intervention into that hysteria. But I have this question, and Betsy inspired me in this, and that is the relationship between the manifesto and the constitution. And I wonder if you could, I'm not sure if the manifesto is in some heterotopic relation to a constitution or not, but Betsy's question about what after the constitution, and what comes after those forceful and utopic and hopeful angry declarations in manifestos. And then I'm thinking, you know, the precision and the politesse of the Constitution, and maybe it's just the law, but it's the nation. But I'm wondering if you would even dare to take on this question of the relation between a manifesto and a constitution.
I love it. This is the first time I've gotten that question, so thank you. I love that provocation, right? Because it's, you know, about, you know, in terms of, you know, if we think of the manifesto as the sort of genre that emerges out of a kind of vernacular insurgency, you know, then the constitution is precisely that genre, that document that emerges out of, you know, out of official double, right? And so in many ways, it is the sort of, you know, legal, political expression of the associations that are sanctioned by the nation state, you know? So that, you know, it would be an interesting thing for me to do to sort of put those, you know, to have them wrestle one another, right? Like, you know, because there's the Constitution and what, you know, the associations that it says are legible, are thinkable, right? And then you have something like the manifesto, you know, which is an implicit dialogue. It's part of what you're saying, is an implicit dialogue and contestation of the Constitution's approved associations. I thought that's a great.
Well, this is the bomb not experience. It's always collaborative based.
I love that. You know, it might be bad. No, this is great. I mean, you know, because, you know, I was teaching Chuck Moretti's Freedom of Violence yesterday, and in the discussion in the grad seminar, you know, one of the things that sort of hit me and the students was that, yeah, a lot of us have been trying to figure out what it means to, you know, kind of de-edipalize our work, you know, this is also, you know, part of the reorder of things, right? You know, like how do you, you know, prove, how the phrase that I use there is how to be in the institution but not of the institution, right? And there's a way in which I'm also trying to, you know, repose the question here, right? You know, so how do you produce collective and subject formations that aren't looking to be licensed by constitutional forms, right? You know, whether the constitutional form is the state, whether the constitutional form is, you know, even something like, you know, the Socialist Workers' Party, right? You know, what affective tools and units does one assume and does one gather in order to, you know, to do that difficult thing, right? You know, part of, you know, I mean, to relate the this project to the one that I just finished, and your question, or your comments in the beginning made me think of this, is that, you know, I wrote that book, The Reorder of Things, as a way to, you know, again, think about what it means to, you know, work with this really vexed formation called minority difference, right? You know, and one that we so often assume, you know, simply by asserting it, simply by advancing it, that we're doing something counter-hegemonic, right? And part of the reason that I want to write the book is to sort of say, that's actually not in line with the history, you know, that corporations, you know, the nation state, universities, you know, have a rich history, an interesting history of taking up minority difference, right? And using it in ways in which, you know, the original authors never really intended, right? And I always thought when I was writing that book, whenever I was reading about the history of artists, and especially visual artists, that there was they got it, they understood long before, you know, those of us in the social science and the humanities came to that issue. They understood that there were ways in which, you know, work by minority artists was being used for hegemonic purposes. And you see that in the statements in the 70s and 80s from, you know, folks like Keith Piper, from Sonya Boyce, I think of the Black British folks, you know, here, Pratibha Parmar, you know. And so the question for me with this project is, you know, how to take that part of the book I just finished, the moment in which, you know, minority difference and sort of minority articulations, you know, get seized by hegemonic institutions, and then also, you know, kind of track the way in which the artists themselves were trying to really confront that question and still do work around minority difference, right? So it's not an issue of, like, you know, because minority difference has been compromised, you abandon it. The question then becomes how to redeploy it. And it seems to me that that's exactly what the artists were trying to do, you know? And that there's a model there for the redeployment of associations.
Thank you very much for your talk. Well, basically my question is, what do you think about things come on? But let me, to explain a little, well, I feel that your talk, or from your talk, I feel that these groups have already identified their desires and are seeking to fulfill their desires or see ways in which to better facilitate their desires. But I've been reading Friends Phenomenon really recently, and I was wondering how or if they have ever actually identified their desires, because Phenomenon seems to say that the he does refer to Martinicans, but to kind of generalize a little, he seems to say that the black men have almost been robbed of their own desire and have been implemented other desires, like the white man's desires. So I was wondering how you thought.
Yeah, that's a great question. The most direct way for me to answer that is to tell you a little bit about what I want to do with black radical traditions, right? And this point that you bring up about Phenomenon, you know, in black skin, white mass, you know, gets it exactly that. You know, part of what I want to do is to sort of, you know, remember I said that a lot of us came of age through black radical groups, you know, politics. a lot of us Black queers. Part of what I want to do is to, you know, sort of deliberate on that. You know, what was it about Black nationalism, or in Fanon's case, a sort of Black internationalism? You know, providing a kind of opening for homoerotic desires. So the part that you mentioned, there's a scene in Isaac Julian's Franz Fanon where the narrator deliberates precisely on that passage from Fanon, but then uses it as a way, the narrator doesn't answer and say, yes, Fanon was right. What the narrator does is sort of open it up and then provide another scene that is about the presence of homoeroticism and homoerotic desires in Caribbean context, you know, particularly in Martinique, right? You know, so part of what that says to me, I mean, it resonates with me a great deal because it says to me that, you know, you don't simply have a relationship in which you reject a Black nationalist text or a Black nationalist history, you know. There's also a way in which there's something within, you know, the sort of erotic traces in Black nationalist texts that also become part of the thing that you build on, even when you disagree with it, you know? So it's like, you know, the narrative disagreeing with Fanon, but still it's a provocation to develop a kind of queer subjectivity, right? So you can think of other moments, I can think of other moments like that, like, you know, the Eldridge Cleaver, you know, stuff about homosexuality, which is in many ways in line with like Fanon's thing that, you know, it is the evidence of a castration. You know, they talk about Black men, you know, Black male castration, right? You know, but the way in which, you know, that becomes the argument around which so many Black queer scholars and artists have organized, you know, at least an interrogation around, and also an interrogation that seems to link their own and other Black queers' development around this argument that is wrong, it makes no sense, but it's part of the DNA, you know? You know, so this is a kind of garbled answer, you know, to your question, but it's one of the things that I want to do is to sort of ask the question of what were the erotic openings within Black radical traditions, right? Now that assumes a few things about Black radical traditions. It assumes that even when they don't talk about homosexuality, right, or queerness, or when they speak badly of it, that doesn't close the door. It actually opens the door for subjective and social development. There's a line in Du Bois's Souls of Black Folk in that chapter of our Norman Strivers where he says, you know, this freedom we still see, or something like that, the freedom to work and think, and then he ends with the freedom to love and aspire, right? Like, in my heart, I know that someone read that, you know, some Black queer child read that, and, you know, thought, okay, here is a bit of encouragement, you know, in terms of a green light, or green lighting, the development of a Black queer subjectivity, right? Or the way in which, you know, for instance, you know, Black queer male artists went to Langston Hughes, you know? Like, there's no objective evidence of Hughes's queer sexuality, but they're building, you know, their own sort of queerness around the suggestiveness of Hughes's homoeroticism, right? So I'm interested in the sort of suggestiveness of Black radical traditions, you know, around the erotic. And, you know, that's a different way of responding to Black radical texts, you know, than one that says, oh, because they said no to queer formations or they were absent, then there is no relationship between the development of Black queer formations and those texts?
There's a lot of organizations, I'm thinking of one in particular, to be honest right now, that have like these homo, just national tendencies that kind of, definitely exclude narratives of certain people and identities. And then you're talking about the breaking off of like the third world, the third world revolution. And so I was wondering, I guess this would be more of a logistical question, how you see that happening in a more modern perspective, how you see, like, if you could talk more to like that, like, pushing back of like an organization, like what that would take, like in a like sense, like now, like if that were to happen now, like how would that like what they would consider like alternative like narrative, alternative organization come like out of like these organizations that are still like on the liberation front, like tactics.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, I mean, you know, like I think it is happening now, right? You know, like it's, you know, the political narrowing of queerness. I mean, we're in that moment. In many ways, I'm also trying to write a book that will, illuminate the histories that have been lost, around the breadth of queer sexualities, the political breadth of queer sexualities, right? Precisely because we're in a moment where, we presume that queer politics is organized around, the platform that the gay rights movement said it's organized around. It's like, the right to the military, the right to marriage, and protection from hate crimes, so there's a way in which we have forgotten the political breadth, that once was, is still, is still in certain sectors. Like, the Entrepreneur Project is one group that's trying, very hard, has been doing it for a long time, to try and maintain the political breadth of queerness and queer sexuality, right? Another one is the Sylvia Rivera Law Project, right? In terms of what it would mean for folks who are in, sort of politically conservative gay organizations, to break away, I don't know. I mean, I think that we're in a moment in which there are things that they broke away, they can go someplace. Like, you can go to Audrey Moore, to the AOP, you can go to Sylvia Rivera, you can go to Southerners on New Ground, that is also not to say, though, that rights-based movements and practices, we just dismiss them, because, rights have their place. The question is, what will be the effect of those rights? Will they close down, the kind of social breadth that is vital for people to live their lives, or will they open them up, The thing about rights is that they, oftentimes close down social breadth, which is why we have to think beyond, rights-based organizations. I'm presuming that part of what you're talking about is like rights-based organizations like, HRC and, yeah. Okay.
I was just gonna say, I think it's sort of the question of that you spoke about earlier, of fighting something within without, fighting an institution without, from within that institution without becoming too much a part of it. And there was an event or a conference earlier hosted by Mr. W, Queer Dreams and Nonprofit Blues, and one of the things they had people from, like, Sylvia Rivera Law Project.
Yeah, totally. Like QEJ is another.
Right. And coming in and discussing this idea of working within the hegemonic nonprofit structure, which is so deeply rooted in capitalism, and this idea of appealing to the people with the money and making them want to donate it while simultaneously fighting the structural violence that has endowed those people with the power they have. And I think it's obviously an incredibly hard question, that's why there was a conference about it, but I think that, I don't know, I think it's, maybe the importance of it is I mean, maybe the only answer is like to have tons of small local projects. I mean, maybe, and I don't know if this, I don't actually think this is the answer, but sometimes I think like maybe the only way to do it is to stay, to have everything stay small enough that it never becomes institutionalized and like only locally based things that can somehow, you know, find ways to come together without. Because I think, you know, once they come together, I mean, you have too many voices that are silenced because of the bigger picture and this idea of needing to wait your turn.
Jump in there.
I'll follow on this because thank you for your talk. And one of the things I found generative about it, and I don't know if this is really where you were going, because when you were talking about the associational aspect of the 16-point platform, I thought that one of the places that you were going was, and, you know, then you went into human, which I totally agree with, but was the way in which these smaller projects can be associated with each other. Because, you know, one of my worries about, you know, ALP, QEJ, Sylvia Rivera, et cetera, is precisely the ways in which they are vulnerable and the difficulty of work and all that kind of stuff. And one of the things I'm wondering is whether your project generates the possibility of a view of assemblage where bringing these together in an associational way that is not a coalition, it's not alliance politics, it's not these older forms, but is some kind of new form that would allow for the smallness of it, that allow for these moments that you've highlighted so well, and yet give some more substantive support and strength and that kind of thing that would mean that you know, organizations that are relatively small and in which people have do work that's very important without a lot of support and the like could find new ways of coming together. And I don't know if that's one of the places you were going, but it occurred to me in relation to this question at least.
Yeah, I mean, you know, like, to me, both of those questions, like, you know, one of the things that I am interested in, you know, is precisely, you know, the agency within small things, you know, within, I mean, you were calling it local stuff, right? You know, but you know, we could also call it small, sort of not quite, you know, institutionalized, which also means that there's a particular vulnerability, you know, to those things, right? Now, you know, Jan, your other part of your question has to do with, all right, given that sort of vulnerability, what can relieve the vulnerability? And is that the moment to sort of then try and link up strategically with the more endowed, right? You know, I mean, and the thing is that may be the case, but we also have to think about the vulnerabilities of the endowed, right?
Yeah.
You know, that like, you know, that is also dangerous territory too, which is not to say don't do it, okay? I mean, that's the thing. You know, it seems to me the critique of purity and authenticity politics means that we also have to be comfortable with, you know, our vulnerability. You know, like, you know, there's that line that I always loved in this interview with Spivak in the Postcolonial Critic, and it's an interview called The End of Politics? And then she says, you know, part of what this, you know, and then it was the language of postmodernism, the language, what this postmodern moment means is that we have to radically accept our vulnerability. You know, and so in many ways, the last book I wrote is about like that kind of a politics based on the radical acceptance, you know, of our vulnerability, right? So that, like, you know, it requires that we understand the workings, the resources, the vulnerabilities of the big, you know, sort of endowed institutions, but also the vulnerabilities, the workings, the endowments of the small, you know, as we figure out, you know, how to, we in the small, engage and disengage from it. You know, rather than, you know, because I think the, you know, oftentimes the presumption is that, you know, sort of, you know, if we were only, I'm thinking about this in terms of like me being in an American Studies department for 13 years, if only we had the endowments of the poli-sci, you know, which means that, all right, then there will be no students of color, there will be no queer students, there will be no faculty of color, there will be no, you know,
queer fact, but you guys are Muslim. You know, so, you know, it's about objectively assessing the agencies and the limitations of both the small and the big, right? You know, because now, you know, right now our politics have been sort of organized around the metaphysics of the big. And I guess what I'm calling for is a sort of reorientation that thinks about the sort of enabling and disabling aspects of them both, you know, that have to sort of go into our own sort of calculus around the kind of alliances, or for lack of a better word, that we might make, you know, the kind of formations that we might produce.
Yeah, I mean, I was thinking much more so that these small things could come together, but in a crazy quote fashion, so that they
wouldn't have to be,
you know, how alliances, like, you have to come together for the strategic.
It could just be
like, well, we kind of crazy like each other, so we're kind of going to do what we can for each other, but we're not going to have this really long meeting where we all agree on everything, and then
I think that's right, and I think that, you know, there are instances in which that happens. I remember, you know, when, you know, just, what, 15 years ago, like, I heard of AOP doing that with, you know, organizations like Oswald, the Palestinian queer organization. You know, I think that that has to become, you know, not this sort of singular instance, but, you know, a kind of model, you know, for future interventions.
Yeah.